righteousness of my own. I had no right to draw near your throne. But Father, you love me still. And in love before you laid the world's foundation, you predestined to adopt me as your own. You have raised me up so high above my station. Down to the bone, nothing I did could ever atone. But Jesus, you paid my debt. By your blood I have redemption and salvation. Lord, you died that I might reap what you have sown. And you rose that I might be a new creation. I am born again by grace and grace alone. And I was in darkness all of my life. I never knew the day from the night. The Spirit, you made me see. And I swore I knew the way on my own. Head full of rocks, a heart made of stone. The Spirit, you moved in. At your touch, my sleeping spirit was awakened. And on my darkened heart, the light of Christ has shone. Called into a kingdom that cannot be shaken. Heaven's citizen by grace and grace alone. So I'll stand in faith by grace. By grace and grace alone. I will slay my sin by grace and grace alone. I will reach the end by grace and grace alone.
Well, would you take just a moment, turn to someone next to you, tell them you're glad to see them in the building at 11 o'clock at night.
For God so loved the world that he gave. so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now with well, I'm walking the freedom. For God so loved, God so loved the world. Hey. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
Like the sun.
the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace.
In vain its builders strive. To you who boast tomorrow's gain, tell me, what is your life? A mist that vanishes at dawn, all glory be to Christ. All glory be to Christ our King. All glory be to Christ. His rule and reign will ever sing. All glory be to Christ. His will be done. His kingdom come on earth as is above. Who is himself our daily bread? Praise him, the Lord of love. Living water satisfy the
church.
All glory be to Christ our King. All glory be to Christ. His rule and reign will ever sing. All glory be to Christ. Thank you.
King. All glory be to Christ. His rule and reign will ever sing. All glory be to Christ.
Well, church, let's pray together. Father, we just thank you so much that before this next year, 2023, we get to gather as a church family and sing gospel songs. And Lord, we don't know all that holds for us in 2023, but we do know that you, as that song just said, you are faithful and true. And so we thank you for who you are. God, you are faithful, you are true, you are sovereign. And Lord, we thank you that you also not only give us yourself, but you give us your family, the family of God, and that we get to celebrate this incoming new year with this wonderful church family. And so we thank you for that. We love you, Lord, and pray that you would just bless the rest of this night. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Well, church, you may be seated. I've said to some of you, good morning, and so collectively, good evening. I've got to be extra intentional with that. As you know, tonight is not a typical Sunday morning gathering. It's a bit different. And so kind of next part of our gathering, we're actually going to have a few people share. And our prayer is that as these few individuals, these awesome people share, that you would just be encouraged, you'd be equipped and empowered for this next year. And so we're excited for each of them to share. And so I'm going to invite the first person up. And if you would just give a warm welcome to this person, that would be wonderful. So I'm going to invite Joseph Bay, if you would come up and give him a warm welcome.
Glad to be here with you guys. Blessed. Good day to be here, and Happy New Year, everybody. So, yeah, I'm here to speak about how God has transformed me and how he's been a blessing in my life and to me and my wife. So every day I think of God, and every day that I have faith towards him because he gives faith towards me, I grow and I come closer to him. I fall and go steps backwards like I wouldn't expect, like all of us do. And he always picks me up. And every day is just a new day. And God's so good. And it's just such a blessing to be in this church and to be a part of this community and to grow with you guys. It's just the transformation has just been amazing. I'm not even the same person that I was 10 years ago here at this church. I've been here almost 10 years now, and God's just been growing in me and my wife, and it's just amazing. Thank you.
Thank you, Joseph. Appreciate that. So we got a couple of more people who are going to share, and so I'm going to invite Emily Rathbone, and she's going to share next. So welcome, Emily.
Good evening, church family. I actually have some notes over here I'm going to grab. I'm sorry, I don't want to forget anything. Forgive me. If we haven't met, I am Emily Rathbone. I'm one of four Rathbones of City Point Church. We're working on more. We're working on it, I believe. So a little background on me. I have been a part of City Point Church for, 2 years now. For most of that time, I have been living and working in Seattle during the week. So I'm a graduate student at the University of Washington, and I work with some incredible young people down there. We're all, 20-somethings. We kind of got the whole range, like 20 to 29. I'm right in there, if you can't tell. God definitely answered some prayers there with the people I work with, and I'm very, very thankful for that. What we do is hard. There's lots of pressure on us, but the people I work with, my coworkers, I'll call them, they make it not only bearable, but I would say even enjoyable, which is something. Long nights at work seem much shorter than they actually are when they're around, and that community is really a special part of my life. Now, not a single one of them follows Jesus. I could name a couple who grew up in church and have since turned away, but not one of them knows God. That can be disheartening, and I think a lot of people are in that boat in their jobs or their school or wherever you're at, and it's easy to feel alone and overwhelmed for me personally, and I've shared that with people, and they seem to agree with that. It's hard, and that community helps me a lot, but it's not something that I can be grounded in. It's not something I can rely on. They're wonderful people, but it's different when they're not believers. So I want to talk about the community that I have here at City Point and the contrast of that. The community I have here is something that I can rely on. Coming home every weekend to be with you guys, to be with my church family, to sing gospel songs together, that grounds me. That gives me the motivation, the energy to go into my work week. And I don't miss it if I possibly can, because I don't want to. I feel it when I miss a week. It's harder, you know? And coming back is even more of a relief, even more of that rest, even more of that kind of peace that I get. And I'm not saying that God isn't down in Seattle. He is, and he's doing wonderful things there. But this is family. This is home. This is where my heart is. So you may or may not know this, but we have an incredible group of young adults right here in City Point Church. And they are passionate about walking with God, and they are working to equip themselves to show God's light well in their jobs and in their families and in their circles of friends. And that, to me, is heartening, coming back and being in fellowship with them and hearing their stories. So earlier this year, we as a City Point Young Adult group did our first core class together. It was called, Big Screen Perspectives. I believe that's happening again now here in January. It was an amazing class. If you haven't done it, I would suggest you sign up for it. But we did a few get-togethers as the young adult crew before then, kind of the, you know, what's your name, what do you do for work, or are you in school, and what was your name again? You know, we try, but you know how it is. When we did the class, that was the first time we were really seeing each other regularly. We met on Saturday nights, and we would start out just eating and talking with each other. And there is something about being with fellow believers regularly that just you don't get anywhere else. When you struggle with things, you know, that's a safe place to kind of share that. There's those who will listen. They will advise you. They will help you. When there's something to celebrate, it's all the better because they will celebrate with you. It helps me a lot to be in groups like that because I hear a lot of unique perspectives. Everyone's coming from a different place. We have so many, like, I'm a graduate student in Seattle. We've got school teachers. We've got dishwashers. We've got it all, right? And everyone's coming to the table with something unique, and to be around those unique personalities, I think it equips me, it helps me to connect with people in my work and school and all of that. So it's certainly a stimulating environment. We're a lively bunch. The class, as I mentioned, was also amazing. I've used what I've learned in that class. You know, I've gotten questions from non-believers who, you know, what's the Bible about? Or I'm like, hey, I got an extra one lying around. Do you want it? And they say, yeah, sure. And I can just kind of speak a little bit, because Big Screen Perspectives, that class, is kind of an overview of the Bible, right? Kind of the big screen, the step back, and a way to kind of write down on a napkin, here's something that's useful for you to know. So if you decide to open up this Bible that I'm giving you, then you can do something with it. You can get something out of it. You have some sort of roadmap, so you're not completely lost. Anyway, after that class ended, we did some events together as the young adults. We went hiking a couple times in the summer, which was really fun. I know that a lot of the young adults broke off into kind of smaller groups. They'd go get coffee together. They would do little Bible studies. No prompting with the Bible studies. There's this hunger for God's word, which is inspiring. We have a group chat where we share prayer requests and we, you know, information about events and stuff that are coming up. Needless to say, it was important to us that we didn't lose contact with each other. We kind of stayed as a unit, stayed cohesive, added new people along the way, which has been wonderful. In October, we did our second class together, which was at least as amazing as the first, and we had a lot more people to the point where it was a discussion of where we will hold the class because will we have enough room? And thankfully, my parents graciously opened their homes to us, so it all worked out. But that is a great problem to have, isn't it? There's such a large group of young people in the church who want to come together, who want to learn about the Bible, who want to connect with each other, that we had to worry about having enough space for all of them. Yeah, it was amazing. So during that time, we were constantly welcoming new people. We had grown in between the classes, but during that class, we were also welcoming new people. And that is a group of people, and this is a group of people that I am proud to invite others into. It's a welcoming group of people. It's a warm group of people. It's a fun group of people. So I am greatly looking forward to this next year of fellowship. I have heard rumor that the young adults will be doing a third class soon. And we're also, many of us are excited to do the Read the Bible in a Year plan together. We're all like signed up on the Church Center app and it's going to be great. So little plug here, if you are a young adult or you know a young adult who's looking to get plugged in with a group, don't be shy in asking for information because we got a great thing going and we're happy to welcome new people into it. We do it all the time. So just to let you know. So I could go on and on about how amazing the community is here at City Point Church. And that was just the young adults. I could talk about many other things, how the staff works to get everyone involved and feeling like they have a place and how welcomed I've felt since I've been here. But I will go ahead and wrap it up. So thank you, church.
It's so challenging when people share. I just want to come up and spend 5 minutes reflecting and talking about what they just shared. But just to keep something, just real quick, just to respond to that, it's just beautiful how God is working, you know, in Joseph's life and Emily's life and all of our lives, but he's using the church to do that, right? That we're growing in the context of community. And not only have they benefited from the church, but I think we as a church have benefited from them. Even tonight, them sharing is a reflection of that. So just super, super awesome stuff. We have one more person who's going to share, and for that, I'm going to invite Nick Martin up. So, Nick, come on up. Give him a warm, warm welcome.
I just want to clarify, Emily, did you say the whole spectrum was between 20 and 29? No. It's okay. I, like, just turned 50, and I'm like, I'm outside the spectrum now. I tell you what, got asked to share a little bit, me and my family. I tell you what, it's been an interesting last 3 years, right, for everybody, and it has been a moment where I've been able to watch, and I feel like I've seen God shake his people up a little bit, going, I need you guys to get uncomfortable again. You know, some of you have gotten a little complacent, and I gotta say, we were kind of, you know, us and our family, we kind of felt that, you know, we had a church they were going to, and it got to a point where we were mostly attending because, you know, mostly the people, you know, were like family, you know, we'd show up there and whatnot. And, you know, in the last 3 years, it really kind of shook us a little bit, you know, and me and my wife, and we're trying to figure out how to parent, how to keep life as normal as possible for our kids, and so we found ourselves kind of hunting and searching and whatnot, and we found ourselves, I think it was a year ago September, that we found ourselves coming over here, and we actually visited City Point a while back, you know, just to meet with other fellow believers and whatnot. But we came back, and I think probably one of the aspects that really kind of excited me, because you know I'm a husband, I'm a man, I'm a doctor, but I'm a dad, and when my kids, when they got excited about coming to church, and they were like even tonight, God bless you, Maddie, I'm gonna talk about you. Okay, we're with family and whatnot, but she comes up to me and she just kind of grabs my arm and she goes, "Dad, can you believe it? We get to be at church late at night. This is so exciting." it just warms your heart. I mean that's a great feeling, you know, as a dad and as for the things that have happened in our life, you know, since joining City Point, I know, Jordan, you've been kind enough to ask me to help out with, just being one of the parent leaders with the youth group, and helped out with, I've been to a winter camp and a summer camp with these kids, with our youth. And, you know, there's part of me going, well, why me? I mean, but, you know, my kids think I'm cool, but I have no idea what other kids think. And it's been a blessing for me, and it's been really, really neat to see these young adolescents, you know, that they're just kind of growing on their own. They're trying to figure things out and whatnot. I still remember you asked about competitiveness and whatnot. I really tried and gave it all my first camp. I pulled back the second camp because I had to recover from that first camp. But I tell you what, my kids are excited about coming to church. You know, in fact, North and Maddie, oftentimes they're all like, "We don't want to be late for discussions, Dad. Can we walk? Because we don't live too far from here." And so they're jumping out and they're going for a walk, you know, to get to church. My wonderful and beautiful wife, you know, is now helping, you know, in an interim position, working with the youth, doing something she's actually very, very good at. And now my oldest, you know, she's got an opportunity to where she's going to be, she applied and got into a 1 year kind of a Bible Institute, where she's going to be studying the Bible for 2 semesters with 2 different opportunities for missions trips, short-term mission trips while she's there as well too. And you know, I get a little choked up because in 10 days, 10 days she's on the plane, and so I'm going to ask for prayer for her, but pray twice for me, as dad, because that's, that challenges me on a certain level, kind of a thing. But City Point Church here, this has quickly become home for our family, and so we thank you for that.
Man, that's great, isn't it? To hear how God is working in men like Joe and women like Emily and men like Nick. It's so encouraging to hear that. I mean, a lot of people think that we're kind of washed up as a society because they look at a young generation that seems quite lost. I would encourage them to attend City Point Church a few times. You have a hope in the future, mainly because of God, but also because of what God is doing in the lives of his people, including his young people, right? And that's exciting It's exciting to be a part of that. I just wonder, I'm going to share a few things with you. You might wonder what's up here. That's coming. That's coming. But I wonder, this is a family moment, right? Family setting where we can just relax a little bit. By the way, you sounded great singing. Good gospel songs, and you sounded great. That was beautiful. Thank you for that. Encourages me to hear us together sing. Okay, yeah. So what we're going to do now, I do not have a sermon, but I have a devotional. I want to share a devotional with you. This and what I was going to say is somehow we're supposed to try to time this to be like at midnight. We say Happy New Year, and that's that. And I'm looking at the clock, and I'm going, I don't know. We might have to pretend it's midnight and say Happy New Year, and that'll be it, because I don't know that we need to be all the way to midnight. But we'll see, because sometimes my sermons go longer, though this isn't a sermon. But what we have tonight, Ben, put that first slide up there, if you would, please. What we have tonight is the great, it's really catchy. It's really catchy. You probably have not heard of this game yet, but it's about to be all the rave, right? It's about to catch on like wildfire throughout the nation, and we will be the first participants and observers of what is called the Great Carve It Out and Hydrate Contest. It's catchy, isn't it? Right? The Great Carve It Out and Hydrate Contest. I told Michael, I said, I made this game up, and I gave it the most crazy, obscure name I could think of. And he said, well, you succeeded in that. So, the Great Carve It Out and Hydrate Contest. What I need is I need 4 volunteers. I've got volunteers coming out my ears. They're all little, all younger kids, which is awesome. But I actually want 2 kids, 1 teenager, and 1 adult. Do I have a brave? I want a brave adult first. Jennifer Isagiri, come on down. Woo! All right. And then I need a teenager. Any teenagers? Right there, Isaac. Come on down, Isaac. Very good. And then I'm going to go with you 2 right here. You guys come on down right here. All right, so go ahead and take your seats up here. Everybody grab a seat. Now, here's this is what's on the line right here. Huh? This is what's called a tiny trophy. Tiny trophies are very valuable. On our church staff, tiny trophies matter a lot, okay? So the fact that I pulled this out of kind of the tiny trophy storage place that is only reserved for staff, and I'm giving it away to the winner of the Great Carve It Out and Hydrate Contest. One of you is very, very honored, okay? All right, so here's the deal, though. Here's what you have to understand. You do not get to make a mess, okay? Now, when I'm playing games, that's how it is. When they do it in other settings, they can do goofy things and make messes, and it's fun, but I don't think messes are fun. So, we're just going to have fun, but we're not going to make a mess. Each of you has a half of a watermelon, 8 ounces of pineapple juice, a little spoon, and a bowl. What you have to do is you have to carve out the watermelon and put it in the bowl, and then take the pineapple juice, pour it into the watermelon, and then drink the pineapple juice. Now, is anybody allergic to either watermelon or pineapple juice? Not that you know of. Okay, excellent. I literally made this up. I have no idea how this is going to go. But we've got a roll of napkins, and we're just going to see what happens. All right? So you're going to carve out the watermelon and put the watermelon in the bowl. And then, now, here's the thing. This is a little secret that people who have never played this before need to realize. You don't have to carve out the entire watermelon to fit 8 ounces of pineapple juice you've got to carve out enough space for 8 ounces of juice. Get it? Okay, this is going to be good. All right, so I'm not sure if we have, do we have any background music or like anything like that? I don't know. Ben, work your magic. Let's figure this out. Okay, now I've got to think if I've said everything I need to say before we play this. I wrote it down. Yeah, but I got to think about it. Okay, you got your spoons. Everybody understands the rules. There's no messes. That's the number one rule. There's no messes. The watermelon goes in the bowl. You ready? Are we good, Jesse? You're good? All right. I don't think it's going to take that much time. So I don't think there's a need for a timer. But pick somebody. Who's rooting for Jennifer? Okay. Remind me of your name. Say it again. Colton. Yeah, Colton. Who's rooting for Colton? Who's rooting for Isaac? Elijah. Who's rooting for Elijah? All right. So, I'll get everybody's names down someday. All right, you ready? On your mark. Get set. Go! Come on, guys. Let's see how they do. Keep going. Yep, it's good. That's really good. Oh! Oh! Wow! That. God. All right, give them all a hand. Good job, guys. So, it's not bad. I'm glad I brought the tarp. So, I don't know. Having 4 or 5 of the 8 ounces run down your chin and is still dripping onto the floor, definitely, yeah. Okay, all right, so we did it. Now you know why that's going to be all the rave. Like, people are going to be playing this all across the country because it's such a thing. Right? It's such a thing. Now, we've learned an important lesson here tonight. You can't wait. You can't wait to play that. Right? You're so excited. It just takes 2 watermelons and some pineapple juice. No, we've learned an important lesson here tonight. I want to walk through this just a little bit, okay? If these watermelons are, they're fine, right? And they're full. And because of the way the game was arranged, now, if we wanted to think outside of the way the game was arranged, then it doesn't pertain. But because of the way the game was arranged, in order to drink the pineapple juice, that's the hydrate part, did you catch that? In order to drink the pineapple juice, we had to carve out the fruit or the meat of the watermelon. And if we didn't carve that out, then the people who were parched, these 4 people up here, parched. If they didn't carve that out, then they would remain dehydrated. They would remain parched, is the word. Okay? So here's what we're going to work on tonight. Try to make this connection, if you will. It's difficult. All of us both need and want to grow in our relationship with God. All of us. We all need it, and some of us feel the want more than others, and you know how it is. If you walked with Jesus for a time, sometimes there's a strong desire, and other times that desire wanes. But we, as followers of Christ, we know we need to grow in our walk with God. And hopefully, our level of want is higher as well, right? So the way we do that, there's lots of ways that we contribute to our growing in our walk with God. We've heard some of it tonight in by way of testimony, the getting together of the family of God, learning together in classes, etc., etc. Right? There's other disciplines and ways for us to do this, but our souls need time with God in order to grow in God. If you will, the space that's carved out is what is needed. Right? So we all want and need to grow in our relationship with God. And here we are in the very, just right on the cusp of a brand new year. And hopefully you've got some things that you're aspiring to in this coming year, 2023. And hopefully one of those things is, I want to grow in my relationship with God. So you're paying attention to, hey, my church family, we're going through a study of the book of Hebrews. I'm going to be attentive to that. Hey, we've got classes, core classes, other activities, natural community coming up in this coming year that I want to be a part of those sorts of things. And those are important, without a doubt. But what we foundationally, fundamentally, one of the things that we need is time with God ourselves, where we're sitting down with the Bible and we're spending time praying and talking to the Lord, right? This is an important aspect of our walk with God. And so we want to grow, we need to grow. Hopefully we're eager about that in 2023. And if we're going to grow in our relationship with God, we've got to invest time. We've got to give time to personal devotions, praying, studying the Bible, along with those other activities. But here's the thing. We don't create that time. God has already done that. It's called a day. It's 24 hours. And there's people who think they're super, 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 super busy. And they maybe are. And there's other people that are like, maybe they got a little more thumb twiddling time on their hands. But it doesn't matter what your schedule is, what you do for a living, whether you're a student or whether you're running your own business or whatever it is that you do to occupy your time, you only have 24 hours. You don't get to create time. If you're going to spend time with God, in order to grow in your relationship with God, you have to carve out time to spend with Him. That's the necessary component. And we could say, well, I'm just so busy, or I just, like, all of those things add up to nothing because we just have 24 hours. It's called a day. God created it, and if we're going to spend time with Him, we have to carve that out. That's what our souls need. That's where we take the living and acting Word of God, the living and active Word of God, and we get it in us. And that's where the Spirit of God begins to work, and He's renewing our minds, and He's restoring our souls, and He's nourishing us and hydrating us, if you will. That takes time. That sort of work does not take place on whimsical prayers, like out the door, God bless this day, I hope that you're with me today, sort of thing. Like, we actually have to spend time with Him and in His Word. And we don't, when we're doing that, if anybody that's already established that as a regular part of their life, as a regular rhythm in their life, they've carved out time for that.
We know what it's like. There's times when that's super rich and we're just like, man, this is powerful. And other times it feels more like a duty. But we do it because we know we need it. And it's a little bit like the nourishment that we get from the food that we take in. There's some food that we take in that there's very little nourishment to it. But let's say that you're a big salad eater, which if you're not a big salad eater, you should be. It's good. It's really good, right? Get those vegetables mixed up together and eat them. They're good for you. But when you're eating the salad, you're just eating a salad. You're crunching away, and sometimes you like it, sometimes you don't. Sometimes maybe it's just all that in a bag of chips, and, well, forget about the chips. But when you eat salad, you're getting nutrition, whether you're fully aware of it or not. And some of you that are salad eaters, you eat it because you know that it's good for you, even if you don't like it all that much all of the time. And others, you just think salad's the greatest thing in the wide world. But you eat it because of the nutritional value. And it's, in a way, it can be similar. There's times when we've carved out time with God, and it just doesn't feel like it's all that nutritious. But you do it anyway because you know it's working. God is at work even when we don't know he's at work, right? And sometimes it's warm and rich, and other times we're just doing it. But we do it because we need it. We know we need it. If we're going to grow, we've got to spend time with God. Personal time, devotional time. And if we're going to do that, we've got to carve that time out. We don't create it. God has already done that. We carve out what he's already given to us. The issue, if there is one, is that we've filled up the time. We've filled up the space with all sorts of things. Some of them are necessary and they're important things. And other things, maybe they're not so necessary and not so important. But all of us have full lives. And so there's things we have to carve out. There's things we got to say yes to so we can do the right things. And things we say no to so we can do the right things, right? Our lives are full. So we've got to carve out that time, that space for this. And we carve this out for God from what he's already given us. That's called a day, as I've said. It's a matter of priority. It's a matter of what matters, right? So what matters? So what I want us to get to tonight is from a silly made-up game is to look into this new year, 2023. That's 51 years since Bob and Joan Burns have been a part of City Point Church. Look into this new year, and I hope that you have aspirations for, in lots of ways, for your household, for your personal health, for work, whatever, right? I hope that that's all, I hope that you're thinking about ways that you're aspiring to improve in the year. It's all great. Call them resolutions or whatever. But my hope is that one of those things, and one of those things toward the top of the list is, I want to grow in my relationship with God this year. And one of the ways that's going to happen is that you carve out time where God gets your undivided attention. So my question to you is, when will God get your undivided attention in this new year? I can remember, I was a brand new believer, less than a year old in the Lord. I was 19. I don't think I'd even turned 20 yet, maybe something like that. And I was just barely getting familiar with the Bible. And I was challenged by somebody to set aside the first part of every day to spend time praying and reading the Bible. And I thought that sounded like a really good challenge. It sounded like a good plan. And he said, just start with 15 minutes. And so that's what I did. I started with 15 minutes. And then I grew that time. As I got accustomed to that, it became a normal part of my rhythm. It has become, now I took that challenge, and that has been my discipline for 30 years now, right? Over. It's here's what I want you to think about, friends. When you're somewhat grown up, nobody has to tell you to brush your teeth before bed. And nobody has to tell you to brush your teeth after you eat your breakfast and go off to work or school or wherever you're going to be. That parents, kids, that's one of the ways that your parents will measure whether you're growing up or not. When they don't have to tell you to brush your teeth anymore. Right? If you're 19, 20 years old and your parents are still telling you to brush your teeth, you've got some growing up to do. Like really quick. Make 2023 the year, right? But here's, it's just normal. It's just, you don't have to think about it. You don't have to write it on the whiteboard in the kitchen. You don't have to, you like give yourself a reminder on your phone. You just know this is what I do. I brush my teeth before I go to bed. And I want us in our growth in the Lord, in the developing of healthy patterns and rhythms in our lives, to get it so much a part of our rhythm that we don't think, well, should I read the Bible and pray today, or should I set the alarm a little bit earlier tonight so that I get up in time for this in the morning? No, it's just a part of who you are. It's a part of what you do because you know it's what you need if we're going to grow in our relationship with God. That's what we need. So there's this passage of Scripture, Psalm 73, that I'm not going to read the whole thing for us tonight, but there's you probably, if you've read it before, you catch a little bit of the pattern. It's interesting because he starts out telling God how good he is. Truly God is good, he says, to those who are pure in heart. And so it begins right, and he's going to share his testimony. And he's going to bring it all around, but he starts out with the goodness of God, and then he begins to talk about how he had nearly messed his life up in a very significant way, and then by spending time with God, he gained the necessary perspective that he needed. This is the pattern through these 28 verses in Psalm 73. God is good, and man, I almost messed up, but then I got alone with God. I spent time with God, and then in the last verse, he says this, "But for me, it is good to be near God. I have made the Lord God my refuge, that I may tell of all your works." And this is what I hope, that we can get this in our souls. It is good for me. You can say this for yourself. For me, it is good to be near God. Let's try it together. For me, it is good to be near God. So carve out the time that's necessary to be near him in this coming year. Now, I've got some handouts. It's a Bible reading plan and a prayer devotional guide that, where are those at? Those were supposed to be, they're over here? Yeah, I'm sorry. So I've got some handouts, and I'm going to just ask a group of you guys, grab those and hand those out to everybody. One for everybody, prayer guide as well as a Bible reading plan. And then I want to pray, and then also as I'm praying, I'm going to ask we've got some people that are going to hand out communion, right? So let's go ahead and get communion handed out. And Pastor Michael's going to lead us in sharing communion. And look at that, Michael, you got 3 minutes to do this. Well, we don't have to do it right at midnight. Let's not rush that. But let's pray together, friends. And let's trust the Lord in this way. Father, as we stand, stand before you this evening on the very tail end of the year 2022, and we're about to launch into a brand new year. It's always a time of reflection and expectation. Father, I pray for my brothers and my sisters, the children, the teenagers, the young adults, and all the rest, Lord. I praise you for these people. that are part of this church family, God, I thank you for them. I love this church, Lord. And I would ask that you will, by your Spirit, speak to us, that it would resound in our souls that it is good for us to be near you. And near you in this way, Lord, that we spend time with you, that we carve out time to take in your word and to be led by, empowered by your Spirit to pray. So help us with this, Lord. Thank you for 2022. Some of it was wonderful and some of it was quite a challenge, but we give you praise in all things. And as we look into 2023, be glorified. Help us to keep in step with you, Lord God. Praise be to your name. Love you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Sounds like fireworks? People are firing those fireworks off a little early. All right. Yeah.
Well, friends, let's try to stay with the fireworks going off and everything. Let's just try to stay in just a quiet moment for a little bit further as you're receiving these cups. We thought, what a great way to end 2022 and to ring in 2023 is through receiving communion together as the church. And I know so many times when it comes to the new year, oftentimes people are looking ahead to what's going to be, and they're looking forward to kind of shutting the door on the year that has been, and or else they're dreading the future and looking back to what was, because so many things change. We can look back at our lives 3 years ago and just realize things are a lot different for us now than they were then. Relationships have changed and circumstances have changed and so many things that have come and have gone. But communion, as we receive it together as a church, is one of those things that reminds us of the constancy of our Savior. Jesus tells us in Luke 22 that we are to do this in remembrance of him. So let's do that together tonight as the church. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 not to receive of communion in an unworthy manner. So tonight, just in a quiet introspective moment, just take a look in your own life and in your own heart for maybe sin that you might not have repented of, and just quietly confess that to our Lord tonight. And as you do that, would you just take the top off of your cup here and pull out this piece of bread. And we're going to receive the bread together. And what I would love to do tonight, just as this family moment, is to ask one of our elders to pray before we receive the bread. So, Mike, would you pray tonight? Let's partake of the bread together. If you can, peel that top layer off of the cup. This is not a good way to start 2023 for me, friends. So as we've got the cup together, I'm going to ask, Bob, would you pray for us tonight with the cup? Friends, let's celebrate that going into the new year with an understanding that plenty of things will change, but our Lord will stay the same and remain the same yesterday, today, and forever. So tonight, right before we leave and go our separate ways, we want to have our own countdown here in the building. It's after 12 o'clock, okay? So here's what's going to happen. If you are a kid, hurry up. You've only got 50 seconds. Come and grab one of these poppers from Pastor Jordan. Do it right now. Do it fast. Nobody get... This is not what we want to have happen. So, if you are an adult that really wants to celebrate, grab one of those poppers as well. We'll have some left over. So, take those next to your parents, and here's what we're going to do. In 27 seconds, we are going to count down. When it gets to 10, we're going to send off those poppers. You twist the bottom. On the bottom, you see arrows. Twist them. Point them in the air. Don't point them in the back of somebody's head. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.